Hello everyone! In today's video, we're going to be talking about CSS pseudo elements, which are one of the most important aspects of CSS when it comes to making dynamic and really powerful CSS that would require tons of JavaScript and HTML to do otherwise. So without any further ado, let's get started now. Welcome back to Web Dev Simplified. My name is Kyle, and my job is to simplify the web for you so you can start building your dream project sooner. So if that sounds interesting, make sure you subscribe to the channel for more videos just like this one. Now to get started, as I mentioned, we're going to be talking about pseudo elements. And if you're unfamiliar as to what those are, that is the before and after tags that you'll see a lot in CSS. And this allows you to add elements into your code strictly from CSS, and it'll either add it before or after. So we're going to take a look at this label down here, this name label, which has a class of required. So we can just say required, and we're going to add a before element to it to see exactly what this looks like. And one thing you'll note is sometimes you'll see this with one semicolon or one colon instead of two colons. And the reasoning for that is that long ago in CSS, there used to only be one colon, so everything was one colon. And then later, when CSS 3 specifications came out, they decided that two colons was how you should do before and after. Essentially, any elements should use two colons. So it'll work if you use one colon or two colons, but you should definitely use two colons because that's the newer way to do it, and that's how it should be done based on the standards. And now to get started, this is just like any CSS element. So we can just come in here, for example, set a width of 10 pixels, a height of 10 pixels, and we can just set a color on it so we can see exactly what we're looking at, and we'll just set it to red. And then lastly, we're just going to make it so that this is going to be display of block so that our width and height actually work. And if you're confused by display block, display inline, I have an entire video on it linked in the cards and description you can check out. So now let's save that, and you'll notice nothing actually changes over here. There's no red box that appears before our name, and that's because pseudo elements require you to use the content attribute to actually set what the content inside of this before pseudo element is going to be. In our case, we don't want any content, so we're just going to set it to an empty string. And now if we save that, you'll see that our red box is showing up before the name. We can do the exact same thing for after. So let's just copy this down, change this to after, and we'll just make it a blue box. And as you can see, below the name, we now have a blue box. And you may think that this is actually showing up before the name label element, but what's actually happening is if we inspect this here real quick and we go into our label, you'll see that the before and after pseudo elements are inside of the label. They actually just go before the content, as you can see this name text here, and it'll go after the content. But it doesn't go before the label or after the label, it's actually inside of the label, which is really important. That means that inputs, for example, cannot have pseudo elements. If we change this to be input, as you can see, we have an input here. We now no longer get a red box above our input, and that is because you can't have a pseudo element on things that don't have content. Inputs, for example, do not have any content. It's a self-closing tag, as you can see here, so we can't use any pseudo elements on it, which is why this before tag is not showing up. And it'd be the exact same thing with the after tag. So now that we have a good understanding of what the pseudo elements are, I want to actually discuss how you can use these in meaningful ways, because making blue and red boxes is pretty useless. And the first thing we can do is this required attribute. And this is actually really easy. A lot of times when you see a form, for example, it's going to have a little star that shows up after the required fields. So what we can do is we can just change this so that our content is going to be equal to that star. So now if we save this, you can see any label that we put the class of required on is going to have a star automatically added to the end of that label. Because you can see the star is nowhere to be seen inside the label, but our after element here is actually adding that star for us. That's one incredibly useful way to use these pseudo elements. Another really common way to use pseudo elements is to add new things to an element, such as a tooltip. As you can see, this button has this data tooltip attribute, which the tooltip text is inside of it, it just says tooltip. And what we can do is we can actually select the data tooltip, just like this, whoops, tooltip. And what we want to do is we just want to add, for example, a after element into this. And inside of here, we want the content to be the attribute. So there's this fancy terminology of an attribute function in CSS that allows us to access any attributes, for example, data tooltip. And now that's the actual content. And if we save this, you see the tooltip is showing up after the text inside of our submit form, inside of our button, which is great. And I actually have an entire blog article about this attribute keyword here, this ATTR function. So if you want to check that out, it's going to be linked down in the description below. Now, to make this tooltip actually work, what we need to do is we actually need to absolutely position our tooltip. So we want to just select our normal tooltip. And what we want to do inside of here, if I spelled tooltip correctly, is we just want to make sure this is position of relative. So that way we can absolutely position this element related to the entire button itself that has the tooltip. And if you're unfamiliar about CSS position, I have an entire video covering CSS position. You can check it out linked in the cards and the description down below. So now that we have that, we can make this a position of absolute. We can set the top to 100% since we want the tooltip on the bottom. We can set the left to 0 and the right to 0. This is just going to make it stretch the entire width. And if you see that, we now have our tooltip on the bottom, which is great. Next thing we can do is add a little bit of margin on the top, let's say 5 pixels. We can add some padding of 5 pixels. And then lastly, let's just add a background color. And we just want to make this light gray, which is going to look all right, I think. So now if we save that, you can see our tooltip is showing up down here. And all we have left to do is just to make it show up on hover only. And now when we hover over our button, you can see our tooltip is appearing and then disappearing when we unhover from the button. This is one of the best ways to use these different before and after pseudo elements, is just adding this little bit of text in, and we don't have to change our HTML. All we have is this simple data tooltip, and the CSS takes care of everything for us. No need for JavaScript, no need for extra HTML. It's really powerful. One thing to note though, is that you can only ever have one after and one before pseudo element for each element on your page. That means this name label can't have two after pseudo elements or two before pseudo elements. So if we tried to come in here and add in a label, for example, and we wanted to add the after pseudo element, and we set the content to, you know, something else, and we save it, you can see it's not actually showing up over here. It's still sticking with whichever content is the most specific, in our case, this one, and it's being overridden. So this content right here is never going to show because it's being overridden by this content here. The same thing goes for before. So if we change this to before, you can see it now moves our star up here, and now our after pseudo element is showing up. But of course, if we change this to before, now it disappears because we can only have one before pseudo element, like I mentioned before. And that's all there is to CSS pseudo elements. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to check out my other videos linked over here and subscribe to the channel for more videos just like this one. Thank you very much for watching and have a good day.